Hi students, so very early in this video sequence we had this model running here, which is a video pictorial of our solar system. It's a very nice animation. We saw a lot of things about the orbits, the sun being at the center, the planets and the rotations and that sort of thing. The question in front of us now is what holds it all together? What holds it all together? Like, for instance, if we just pick a planet like Jupiter coming around as it turns this corner, why doesn't Jupiter just zing off in that direction? Or as Mars comes around this way, why does it just zing off in that direction? What is it that about this system here that keeps the planets staying in these nice, neat orbits or circles around the sun? Why does it do that? The one-word answer to this is, of course, gravity. Gravity is what holds the solar system together, for sure. So let me explain a bit more. Here's sort of a still shot of the same thing that isn't going to move. And then what happens is the question I sort of asked then is, say, as Jupiter, say, starts humming around this orbit right here and it gets to here, my question was, why doesn't it just sort of keep zinging off into space? What is it that causes Jupiter to turn then and keep coming around this way? And what it is gravity. And so it turns out that gravity is kind of an interesting law that says the following here. The force of gravity, which I'll just say sort of force due to gravity, or F sub G here, is sort of equal to, let me not even say equals, let's just say sort of behaves like M1 times M2, and I'll say over D squared. We'll sort of leave it like that. So the way the law of gravity behaves, it says, okay, I will give you a force. This was discovered, of course, this is one of the big achievements of Isaac Newton. He said, look, gravity is going to give you a force, force due to gravity, if you give me the following things. You give me mass number one, which is that mass right there. You give me mass number two, which is this mass right here. This is an equation that you would plug into, but we're not going to worry about that. So you just give me two masses. That's what he said. Give me two masses. And the last sort of part of this here is with the two masses. You give me some distance between them. This is what Isaac Newton says you need. You need two masses, mass one, mass two. Give me some distance between them. And if you do that, if those conditions hold, I will give you a gravitational force. That's what this theory predicted. So you look back at the solar system here and you say, well, do we have masses? Well, yeah, we have a lot of masses. We have the sun here. We have planets around here. And all of these are made out of rocks and gas and dust and whatever you want, but they're very massive. So we can easily pick two masses. We could easily pick Mars and Jupiter. Would there be a gravitational force between them? Yes, there would, because there's a distance between them and they contribute two masses. But the important part structurally about the solar system isn't so much the gravity between two planets, but the gravity that the sun exerts on either one of the planets. And the reason is because the sun here sits in the middle here. The mass of the sun is so large, you would really think of it as something like this. It has a very, very large mass, much larger than anything else in the solar system. So if you'd go back to Newton's original thought here, the sun's mass is just going to dominate anything else you might see out there. So we're really interested in terms of what holds the solar system together. It's really what gravitational force is the sun exerting on either planet, either of the planets. And so the way it would look then would be something like this. Let me get rid of some of these things here. Look something like this. You go, okay, let's just take Jupiter right here because I have it sitting right here. We'd say that the sun sort of would be M1 and Jupiter would be M2. So in other words, the pieces that Newton says are required for his gravity puzzle. And the distance between them would, of course, be the direct line that joins the two. That would be D right there. And so what Newton says then is that if you have these pieces here, you have a mass and a distance, then you will get a gravitational force. In other words, the sun then will be able to pull Jupiter towards it like this with the gravitational force F sub G, which is just what I sort of told you he predicted up there. And that in a nutshell is sort of why Jupiter, when it gets to this point, doesn't zing off that way into outer space, because it would certainly like to go that way. Like, its speed is definitely carrying it in that direction, but gravity is pulling it in this direction. So no matter what Jupiter tries to do, if it tries to go off this way, gravity will pull it in this way. If it tries to go off that way, gravity will pull it in that way. You're always going to have, no matter what as it travels, you're always going to have this inwards force of gravity because of the sun's huge mass sitting here, the M1 and the M2, and the sun is so large. And the sun does has that effect on all the planets. It pulls Mars in, it pulls Saturn in, it pulls Mercury in, it pulls Neptune in, it pulls Uranus in, and where's the Earth? Here's the Earth behind the sun. There's the Earth by their back, pulls in like that. The sun has this effect on all of the planets. So really, the solar system is held together by gravity. In this case here, O is toward the sun. Okay, more to come.